With a king like this to lead us, no force on earth can stand against us. This is a quote from a story about Alexander the Great. And now with this video in the series, we're going to move beyond the Spartans, who to me were the supreme collective expression of the warrior ideal, meaning a society, a culture all together, to what in my mind was the exemplary individual expression of the warrior ethos and the warrior archetype, and that's Alexander the Great. So who was Alexander the Great? Alexander the Great's era was 130 to 150 years after Thermopylae. Greek states had kind of fallen to some extent after years of civil war and so on and so forth. Alexander came out of the country to the north of Greece, Macedonia. His father, Philip of Macedonia, was probably the greatest warrior general of all time up to that point, who, sadly for his sake, was so eclipsed by his son. But Philip invented the sarissa phalanx, the companion cavalry. He really invented warfare. He invented the nation, in a sense, but that's a whole other story. Now, Alexander came down out of Macedonia with his, as an 18-year-old, while his father was still alive, and they basically conquered the states of Greece other than Sparta. And then Philip was assassinated, and Alexander, at age 20, 21, kind of took over this enterprise that his father had started, which was to conquer the Persian Empire, the land of Xerxes and Darius and Cyrus the Great, the greatest empire the world had ever seen. So Alexander came down, he left a garrison in Athens and the other Greek states to kind of hold them in place. And then he set out across the Hellespont with his army, which never numbered more than 50,000 men, with the intention of conquering Babylonia, the whole thing, the city of Babylon, Persepolis, the entire Persian Empire. And by the age of 25, he had done that. So here are a couple of stories about Alexander, just to give you a sense of who he was and how he led. The story goes that Alexander and his army were crossing a waterless desert, and it had been many, many days or hours since they'd had any water or anything like that. Horses and men were suffering terribly from thirst. And suddenly, a detachment of scouts came galloping back into the king, to Alexander, and they had found a small spring and managed to fill a helmet with water. And they came and they brought it back to the king, to Alexander, and presented it to him. And the whole army had stopped in place, of course, and they were riveted watching this scene as the scouts gave the water to Alexander. And Alexander took the helmet of water, thanked the scouts for bringing it to him, and then without touching a drop, he poured it all out into the sand. And at that moment, a cheer erupted from one end of the column to the other. And a soldier was heard to say, "With a king like this to lead us, no force on earth can stand against us." So that gives you one sense of what Alexander was. The point of his leadership style was always that he led from the front. He always put himself in the greatest danger. Riding on his great war horse, Bucephalus, he would be the first one to charge into the enemy wearing a double-plumed white helmet so that he would stand out so the enemy could see him and shoot everything they had at him. His style of leadership was to indicate that he would never ask anything of his men that he himself wasn't willing to give. Now, here's a second story about Alexander to round this out. Maybe 10 years later, the army had advanced, they had conquered everything, and were all the way in India, heading for what Alexander thought of as the shores of ocean, with a capital O, kind of the ends of the world in that era. And the army mutinied, basically. They had just had enough. They'd been gone from home for too long, and they just said, "We can't take it anymore. We've got to go home." So Alexander called them all together, and basically he stripped naked, took off his tunic, took off his armor, and revealed on his body all the scars that he had gotten from all the various battles. He had been shot with arrows, with spears. He had stones thrown on him and had his skull fractured climbing walls. He had broken legs falling off walls attacking cities. And so he said to his men, "Brothers, I show you the scars on my body, and you'll know that every one of them is in the front. Every one of them has been got in service to you, to help you in this expedition. But I'll make you a deal, he said. If one of your number can stand forth and show on his body more scars than I have, then I will yield to you and we'll go home. And there was like long, long silence. And then the army burst into a cheer again. And they begged Alexander to forgive them for their want of ambition and aspiration. And they begged him to lead them on farther. What we're getting to here when we start to talk about Alexander as an individual is a combination of two archetypes. The warrior archetype that Alexander absolutely embodied in terms of courage and placing himself in harm's way, and the king archetype, which is an archetype beyond the warrior. And it'll be interesting as we tell some more stories here, because Alexander, great as he was, he took the warrior archetype into another area where ethical issues and moral issues began to enter the picture, whereas they never did in a battle like Thermopylae. That's what we'll be talking about over the next few episodes, the warrior archetype and the king archetype, as embodied by probably the greatest warrior of all time, Alexander the Great.